This is the day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning. I am so glad to see you on a wonderful Sunday. Good to gather together, though we gather separately. However you're joining us, if it's on the couch, the dining room table, in the living room, I'm so glad that you are here. It's going to be a great couple of services this morning that you're watching right now, and then this evening at 6 o'clock. A few things to remind you of. Of course, the first and foremost thing that ought to be on the mind of every one of God's children is Easter Resurrection Sunday, just 1 week away on April the 12th, and I know that you'll be joining us, but we want to invite as many as we possibly can. Now, you might be asking, how can I ask people? We can't do the cards. I can't go to their door. How do we do that? Well, it's very simple. One, early this week, God willing, as long as the shipping is timely, we will be getting in yard signs that you can put in your yard. And if you would like to have one of those, we've had many that have been claimed, but there are still more that can be. We would be even glad to come by and put them in your yard for you. If you want to call us here at the church and leave a message, area code 760-241-7876, we'll be glad to put them in your yard. Now, there are some problems with that. For instance, I've heard from two people this week that are watching us from around the world, one in Afghanistan and one in another part of the world. I can't get the sign to you this week, but just about everybody else who wants one, we can get one to you. And those are Easter Sunday signs. Directs them right to our church website. Also, throughout the week, we'll be putting up different posts on Facebook. We'll be adding an event on Facebook. We'll be asking you to share that with as many people as possible. For all the hundreds that we have on Facebook, imagine if we were to all share that with our friends and our contacts. It would be thousands of people who potentially could be reached with the gospel just by sharing. Or you can do this, text or email or call. There are many ways to do it. We want to do all we can to get the gospel out, especially next Sunday, 11 o'clock and 6. By the way, sometimes we alter the time for Easter. We won't need to do that. We want to keep our meeting time right now consistent. So it will air at 11 o'clock next Sunday morning, just like you're watching now, and 6 o'clock next Sunday evening. Also want to mention this, we should be beginning video online Bible studies for different groups here in the next few days, and you keep your eyes open to that, and you'll be seeing and hearing more information about that in the very near future. And a big, big thank you. On Saturday morning, we had just about 100 care packages go out from our church to different ones, high-risk members of the church family, different ones who received care packages. I want to say thank you for those drivers who went out. By the way, no personal contacts were made. We just knocked on the door, rang the doorbell, and then set the package down. They can get it however they chose to go outside and get that to remain in the proper distance, as they were getting those packages. But a big thank you. There is such a great spirit in our church right now. Let's keep it that way, because we remember something. God is in control. May the Lord bless you, and we'll continue on with the service.
No reason for living, and no hope of smiling again. Imagine a world with no golden daybreak, enclosed by the blackness of sin. Then this scene is bathed in beauty and glory. Transform my love's sweet embrace. The hands of the Savior erase all my sorrow and painted this picture of grace. The eyes of picture how beautiful my life could be. Where once was a portrait of gloom and despair, this masterpiece hangs in its place, and it's signed with His blood, and it's framed with His glory, this beautiful picture of grace. The ashes and ruins that once filled the picture have vanished and faded from view, and beautiful touches of mercy adorns this picture He painted anew. Such peace fills the eyes of the man He created. A smile gently rests on His face as Jesus erased all the guilt of my past and painted this picture of grace. How skillful the hands of the artist who painted this picture of me. He saw with the eyes of the master how beautiful my life could be. Was a portrait of gloom and despair, this masterpiece hangs in its place, and it's signed with His blood, and it's framed with His glory, this beautiful picture of grace. Where once was a portrait of gloom and this masterpiece hangs in its place, and it's signed with His blood, and it's framed with His glory, this beautiful picture of grace, this beautiful picture of grace.
Morning, I would actually like to begin our message with a word of prayer, if you join me, please. Our Father, I come to You right now, at the very beginning of this message, before we even look into the Word of God, and ask for Your strength, ask for Your help. I pray, Father, for different ones in the church family I've spoken to or struggling through the circumstances around us, and some outside of the particular circumstances of what has happened with this virus. And Father, I pray for them. I pray now for this message, that You'd bless it, You'd use it, and Father, You might touch lives in Jesus' name. Amen. In my conversations with people over the last several weeks, often by text or by phone call or by email, there are certain thoughts, certain attitudes, certain things that come up over and over, and they're varied. I was talking to someone the other day that different people have different reactions to all of this. For some, there's concern, and there's a small level of concern. There's a larger level of concern. You're concerned for yourself, your own well-being. You're concerned about even going to the store, concerned about getting out at all. You're concerned for a family member, and you think about them constantly, ways to keep them safe. There are others who your attitude right now would be one of stress. There's just different things, whether financially, with your job, with your family. There are others that are experiencing a great deal of frustration, and I might even add anger. There's a certain number of folks, even within our church family, that your greater concern is with what will happen with the economy of our country. And in speaking with different people, there are different reactions. That's really just who you are and the concerns or the stress level or the frustration that you have. And I want to address every one of those today in this message with you. And you'd say, how can we address all of those in just a few minutes? Well, first of all, trust me, it won't be a lengthy message. I can address it not by addressing each particular group, but I can address it today by one name. It is a name that all of us can rally around. What's in a name? I was thinking this week of different popular names. There's still one name that we'll remember in a moment that stands out above all. But what's in a name? The most popular baby names last year in 2019 for boys was Liam. He topped the list. So if there's any parents of a little boy named Liam, that's the number one name in America today. Noah, old name, made new again. And there's William. Liam's a great name, actually, for a boy. It means strong-willed warrior. Noah means rest. William, if you think about it, Liam comes from the name William, but it means a strong protector. My favorite, it's still in the top 10, my favorite name is Jackson because the meaning of the name comes very simply to you. The name Jackson, you know what it means? It means son of Jack. For girls, there's Emma, there's Olivia, there's Ava or Ava, and Emma means universal. Olivia means an olive tree, speaking of peace. Ava or Ava means like a bird, all beautiful names, and I know of some in our church family who have little ones with those names. But there is a name, whether your name is Joel, like mine. I've always liked my name because almost every place I go, I'm the only one there with that name. Or whether your name is William, or it's Olivia, or it's Jackson, son of Jack. There is a name that is above all names. There is a name that stands above. And even in the chaos, there is one name that cuts through it all. It is the name that we find in our text today. And I'd like for you to join me in Isaiah chapter number 9, if you will. Isaiah chapter number 9. And once you find the chapter, I'd like you to join me in verse number 6. Now, as soon as you find it, or if you know Isaiah 9, 6, you're going to be thinking that I'm preaching on the wrong season. You're going to find it, Isaiah 9, 6, and you're going to think, Pastor, it's not Christmas time. We're heading into Easter time. I know that. But this verse in particular, one word in this verse has really jumped off the pages of the Word of God to me in the last several weeks. And I want it today to serve as a rallying cry for us. Whatever your concern or maybe even lack of concern through all of this that you may have, there is one name that is our rallying cry. Isaiah chapter 9, verse number 6. The Bible there says, "For unto us a child is born." Now wait right there. Some of you are saying, Pastor, again, it's not Christmas. I know that, but remember something. Jesus didn't stay a baby. He grew. He lived. And notice what it says. Unto us a son is given. Think about something. That gift of Jesus was presented to us in the form of a baby, but he didn't stay a baby. He grew, and he was given, think of this, a baby given to die. This week we think and we consider and we remember, and in a few days we celebrate the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of peace. His name shall be called, and then these different descriptions, we're going to focus on one today. But his name, the name that stands above, the name that cuts through it all, the name that rallies all of us together, whether we are young or old, whether we are concerned or unconcerned, whether we are angered at what happens in our world today and in the coming days, or we have no anger or frustration whatsoever, what rallies us all together is the name, the person of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, his name, Jesus, shall be called, consider this, Wonderful. Among all the other descriptions, and they're all fantastic, the one that I want us to focus on today is his name is Wonderful. And I want you to consider this today as we preach on this thought. No matter where we are, he's still wonderful. Whether you're stressed, He's still wonderful. Whether you're concerned for yourself or your loved ones, He's still wonderful. If you're struggling today, He's still wonderful. Think of this, wonderful in the past. I wish I could bring up some different ones onto the platform today, but I can't. They're dead and gone from us for hundreds, if not thousands of years. I wish today that I could bring Noah. We brought his name up a few minutes ago. I wish today that I could bring Noah up to the platform and ask him one question. Could you tell the people, has God been good to you? And what do you think his answer would be? My, oh my, he's been good to me. For 120 years I was building that ark and I was made fun of and I was mocked by a godless world. Yet still God was good to me till the day he locked me into that ark that I built because he told me to. He protected me. He's good to me. He brought my family through. He was good to me. You ask me, Noah would say, was he wonderful to me? Absolutely. I wish to this side I could bring to you a man by the name of David who, as just a young man, he was anointed to be the next king of Israel, yet there was already a king. And I would ask him, in those days in the cave, when you were struggling, when you were hurting, was God good to you? And undoubtedly, he would say yes. Beyond yes, he was good to me, even wonderful to me. He brought me through when I didn't know that there would be a way, when I didn't understand, and the stress of my circumstance were to come. You ask me if he was good to me, and I would say a wholehearted yes. I would bring up here a man by the name of Peter, and you would say, Peter, was God good to you? Oh my, he would say, how patient God was with me. When I denied him, he was still good to me. When I didn't understand, he taught me. When I didn't have my own strength, he was my strength for me. You ask me, Peter would say, has God been good to you? And he would say, absolutely, yes. I wish back to this side that I could bring the apostle Paul and say, Paul, was God good to you? And he says, well, 3 days and three nights I was in the deep. I was shipwrecked. I was beaten. I was imprisoned. I was left for dead. All the care of the church. You ask me, was God good to me? He would say, God led me through it all. God is good to me. So I ask you now, those men and others through the pages of the Word of God, and Esther and Ruth, and down through the ages of Spurgeon and Amy Carmichael and Jim Elliot and those who have gone before, now we stand here today, and I ask you this question, has God been wonderful to us? And I ask you to consider where God has brought you from. I ask you to consider what God has done for you. I ask you to consider this, has God ever failed you? And for all those who are watching this message, I ask all of us, has God been good to you? Has God been wonderful to you? And I would say, all of us would say, amen and amen, he's been good to us. And so if others can say, he was wonderful to me in the past, if we today can say God has been wonderful to us up to this point, then all of us in our lives can hold on to this promise from the Word of God. His name shall be called Wonderful. That is the eternality of our Lord. In the past, wonderful. Today, wonderful. And he ever shall be wonderful to us. Wonderful? You would say, what does that name of that? What does that name of Christ mean in the Bible? Wonderful. Wonderful means miraculous. Our Savior is a miraculous Savior. The word, the name, wonderful, means lovely. Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as that lovely name. Wonderful means distinguished, one who stands out. Have you ever been in a place where somebody walks in and their aura just fills a room? Their personality, I've been there. Some of them are well-known. Some of them are not well-known. But the moment they walked into a room, it's just like the whole room gravitated to them. They were people of distinction. distinction. They had an aura, a gravity, a weight. That word wonderful means that. It means to be distinguished. And when you bring all of those descriptors together of the name of Jesus and the person of Jesus, here is what that word wonderful, when you wrap all of those words, miraculous and lovely and distinguished, and you bring them together, it means to place in awe of. From the very beginning of these online services that we're doing, when my wife plays on the piano, whatever song it would be, Victory in Jesus, it ought to put us in awe. His name is wonderful. It ought to put us in awe. To the time that we pray that we, because of the work of Jesus Christ, are able to bow our heads and pray to God Almighty, who, if we are saved, is our Heavenly Father, ought to put us in awe that we, as weak and frail people, are able to do that because our God is a good God and we stand in awe of Him. His plan was wonderful. You consider, God looked at our sin. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12 would say, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. You consider this, think of with me, this coronavirus, they're asking us to distance ourselves. Just a few days ago, they asked us to wear a mask. They've been going back and forth on that. Now we're being asked, if we're out in public, to wear a mask, to wear gloves, to stay at our home, and if not at all possible, in our home as much as possible to help prevent the spread of this dreaded virus that impacts so many lives. There is one disease that no matter what we did, we can't prevent the spread of it. It's the virus, the disease of sin. All of us have been touched by it. As by one man, Adam, sin entered into the world and death passed upon all men. Consider this, for that all have sinned. That's straight from the Word of God. That's exactly what the Bible teaches us. And God's plan, when He knew that man would sin, and He did, God began in eternity past to prepare the way for the redemption, the forgiveness of a fallen man. You see, that sin presented me with a need, because without forgiveness of sins, there is no redemption. I have no hope. And this week, when we consider the death, the burial, the resurrection, as we will celebrate next Sunday, we consider His death and His burial right now. We consider the work of Jesus Christ. It is done because of our need. We, without Christ, are of all men most miserable. We are hopeless. And if you're watching me today and you don't know Christ, you are without hope. I don't say that to be unkind to you. I say that because it's the most kind thing I could ever say to you. Because the Word of God said of Christ Himself, He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me. In His plan, He saw our need. And in His wonderful plan, God knew the remedy, that there was only one. I cannot die for you. Man cannot die for man to redeem a fallen person. Why? I and you, we are fallen ourselves in our sin. It would take a sinless, spotless sacrifice without blemish. Only one would qualify. There were no other options. It's only Jesus Christ, who God Himself enrobed in human flesh. He became one of us that He might redeem us. And He who knew no sin became sin for us. His name shall be called Wonderful. But in that remedy, there's a wonderful preparation. He did come. I read earlier, unto us a child is born. We celebrate that every Christmas. I love Christmas time. May I be honest with you? Christmas is not the number one holiday for a Christian. We might enjoy it, but the great holiday for any believer, the greatest day on the calendar, is that day when we remember on Easter the resurrected Savior. The The beautiful thing is, as you watch this on a Sunday, every Sunday is a celebration of that resurrection. But he came. He lived a perfect, spotless, sinless life, the only one qualified. He taught, and he was a masterful teacher. I do what I can to try to learn different things about teaching. I try to connect with people at their level. I've enjoyed and I've gotten good feedback from these little science experiments that I do with the kids and put out there. Why? I want to reach the boys and girls at their level. And I appreciate Brother Daniel Solario with the videos that he does for the young people. And I know what he's doing with the Spanish ministry. Why? He wants to reach them at their level. And Brother Ted with the teenagers, we want to reach them at their level. But myself and all of us, no matter what we could do, we couldn't teach like Jesus did. He wrote the book. But he didn't come just to be a teacher. He performed miracles. His first earthly miracle performed at the wedding feast of Cana, where he turned the water into wine. He healed the blind. He healed the lame. He raised the dead. He made people to walk again, deaf to hear, eyes that couldn't see. And he performed miracles, but he didn't come as just a miracle worker. There came a day in which he entered Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, today being Palm Sunday. We think about that. He entered on the back of a donkey, and the crowds adored him because of his teaching and his miraculous work. And they thought, he's going to be our Messiah to rid us of this Roman rule. And they waved palm branches, and they cast him on the street and their coats before him. And they hailed him, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Those same voices, just days later, cried out, give us Barabbas. Away with him being Christ. Let him be crucified. Those same voices that cried Hosanna would soon cry, crucify him. He was betrayed in the garden after that last Passover meal when he instituted the Lord's table. In the garden, he was betrayed with a kiss. He was led away as a common prisoner. That Savior, his name called Wonderful, was brought before the high priest and his father-in-law, Annas and Caiaphas. And they had a mock trial. And he was condemned to die for blasphemy, for simply stating who he was, the very Son of the living God. Yet they falsely accused him in a mock trial. He was sent away to the Roman ruler of the land named Pontius Pilate. Pontius wanted nothing to do with him. So Pilate sent him away to the Jewish ruler of the land named Herod. Herod didn't want to mess with it. Herod sent him back to Pilate. Ultimately, Pilate relented and sent him away to be beaten and ultimately crucified. That one, Jesus, who is wonderful to us, consider this, instead of praising him now, they mocked him. Instead of shouting Hosanna, they beat him. Instead of telling him of his greatness as he rightfully deserved, consider this, they spat upon the face of our Savior, this one that we call wonderful. That's why in Galatians chapter number 6, Paul tells us that he would only glory in the cross of Jesus Christ. Why? Christ endured everything that we deserved. We don't glory. He wasn't saying to glory in a physical structure of a cross. He was speaking of the cross, particularly of Jesus Christ. And in that moment, that cross became a royal throne, not because of its wooden structure, but because of who was on it. The cross is not a shrine to us. The cross is not an idol to us. The one we worship is the one who was on that Christ. And what Paul was saying is this, I will glory in Jesus and what he did for me, beaten, humiliated, and then crucified. His visage was marred beyond any measure on that cross. His body was a bloody pulp. It said that you really couldn't even distinguish whether that was even a human being upon the cross, a crown of thorns plaited upon his head, his body beaten, the spikes driven in, and he did all of that for us. Yet in that day, in Matthew 27 and verse number 36, the Bible says these words, they watched him there. And they would have been, yes, those close to him, his mother, and those other ladies that were near, and John. Then those others in the crowd who were afar off, who knew that they had denied him. I would imagine some of those other disciples were out there mingled in the crowd, so not to stand out. But there were also those there who mocked him. There were Roman soldiers there who didn't care a thing about it. They were just performing a duty, and they were brutal men. There is one, a Roman centurion, who looked up and said, "Surely this is the Son of God." The vast majority, it says, they watched him there. And as we watch him, we watch the one who is God Almighty, God in the flesh, who came to die. A teacher, yes, but he came to die. A wonder worker, yes, but he came to die. I tell you, next Sunday, we will get deeper into this, but our Savior didn't stay dead. He rose again, up from the grave. Death could not hold him. The grave could not keep him. We're having Easter services. We're meeting separately. You can't stop Easter. The devil tried a long time ago, and he wasn't successful. We may not be able to gather all together as we normally would, but Resurrection Sunday will come, and we will rejoice because we serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. Yes, he is simply wonderful. He lived, he died, he rose, and he lives forever, evermore. There is something that I have done that people have found a blessing in their lives. And I want you to consider this. This book, yes, the verse we focused on today, his name shall be called Wonderful, the one we stand in awe of. But you go all throughout this book from cover to cover, and it's all about Jesus. That he would come, that he did come, that he died, and that he lives again, and he leads his church, himself being the chief cornerstone. In addition to this verse, something came to my mind this week, and I thought it's come to my mind, and I want to share it with others. Something I've done before, here and in other places, because God has used it. It is to see who our Savior is all throughout the book. Would you pay attention to this? In Genesis, Jesus is creator, for all things were made by him. In Exodus, he is the deliverer, the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he's our great high priest, our eternal sacrifice. And in Numbers, Jesus is the trusted guide, a cloud in the daytime and a pillar of fire in the darkness of night. In Deuteronomy, he's the prophet who is greater than Moses. And in Joshua, he's the captain of our salvation and the one who leads us into the promised land. In Judges, he is both judge and lawgiver. In Ruth, he is our kinsman redeemer. In Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles, he's the prophet of the Lord and the reigning king. In Ezra, he is the one who fulfills his promises. In Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of the broken and the torn down walls in our lives. And in Esther, Jesus reveals the providence of God. In Job, he is our ever-living redeemer. In Psalms, he is our shepherd and our song. In Proverbs, he is wisdom. In Ecclesiastes, Jesus is our only hope. In the Song of Solomon, he's the bridegroom, the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley, the lover of my soul. In Isaiah, he is wonderful, counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. In Jeremiah, in Lamentations, he is the potter who puts our broken lives back together again. In Ezekiel, he's the watchman of our soul and our high tower. In Daniel, he's the fourth man in that fiery furnace. In Hosea, he's the faithful forgiver and the everlasting love. In Joel, he's the one who will pour out his spirit on all flesh. In Amos, he's our burden bearer. In Obadiah, Obadiah, he's our Savior. In Jonah, he is merciful and full of grace. In Micah, he's the ruler called out of Bethlehem. In Nahum, Jesus is our avenger. In Habakkuk, he is the one who justifies by faith. In Zephaniah, Jesus is the Lord, mighty to save. In Haggai, he's our stronghold in the day of trouble. In Zechariah, he's the one whose feet will stand in that day on the Mount of Olives as king over all the earth. In Malachi, he is the Son of Righteousness, rising with healing in his wings. In Matthew, he is Messiah and King. In Mark, he's the wonder worker. In Luke, he's the Son of Man. In John, he's the Son of God. In Acts, he is our ascended Lord. In Romans, Jesus is our salvation. In 1st and 2nd Corinthians, he is the Redeemer and the Lord of glory. In Galatians, Jesus is the one who sets us free. In Ephesians, he is the chief cornerstone. In Philippians, he's the God who meets our every need. In Colossians, he's the hope of glory. In 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, he is our soon coming King. In 1st and 2nd Timothy, he's the mediator between God and man. In Titus, he's our great God and Savior. In Philemon, he is the friend that sticks closer than a brother. And in Hebrews, he's the blood that washes away my sin. In James, he's the great physician. In 1st and 2nd Peter, he's the chief shepherd. In 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, he is our righteousness, our truth, and our love. In Jude, he is the one coming with 10,000s of his saints. And in Revelation, he is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. What I'm trying to tell you is, no matter where you are today, no matter what your discouragement may be, no matter what your frustration may be, no matter what your hurt may be, Jesus is still on the throne. Trust him. He's cared for you to this point. He'll care for you through everything that you're facing. He's led you to this place. He will lead you through this place. And he's taught you and he's protected you, and he will. So Christian, trust him. Christian, love him. Christian, stand for him. Christian, proclaim him. No better time than to proclaim the Savior than right now, in this moment in our history, to stand and say, I am a child of God because of Jesus Christ, my Savior, and he is wonderful to me. But if you're here watching this video right now, and you're watching this service, I plead with you to know the Jesus that I just described. Everything I gave is who Jesus is in every book of the Bible. And this whole message has been to tell you and to tell those who are already believers that Jesus is the hope. This week, we remember his death, his burial, his resurrection. I tell you, Jesus died for you. He gave himself for you. And what's called upon for you, choose Jesus Christ as the Spirit of God works in your life. And you're watching this and you're wondering what is going on. I can tell you, I rest solid and dependent upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you have questions, I'd love to talk with you. You can contact us here at the church. You can call the church number at 760-241-7876. We'll be available for you. We will help you. We will show you from the Bible how you can be saved. Would you call us? Would you talk with me? I'd love to speak with you. You can go to our website, bbcv.org, and you can find the contact page, and you can email me, you can email another, and we'd love to be in contact with you. Though distance separates us, nothing separates the power of the gospel, and I plead with you, if you don't know Christ, come to him today. If you know him, trust him. If you know him, lay aside all those human fears and concerns and doubts and stresses and frustrations and trust him, follow him, because he will lead you all the way. Our Father, I come to you and I pray that the point of this message has made its way home to everyone who's watched this, everyone who's watching right now. And Father, that we would learn what it is to truly depend upon you, because Jesus is the name above every name. And this week, as we consider his work for us, may it be more and more evident and real to our lives. And to anyone watching this who does not know Christ, may they come to the Lord today. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm so glad that you've watched today. I trust that you'll be back for the evening service tonight, 6 o'clock. Be there at your appointed time. Get the whole family together. Encourage someone else to watch this with you. May God bless you, and we'll see you tonight at 6 o'clock.